everyone.
We have our Bibles. We want to call your attention to raising the Bible in your right hand and say, "Answer number five."
Right alone.
Let every word that we see
the mouth of God.
Thank you for your patience on tonight. We have to answer question. Question has come to us in the book of Hebrews, chapter 5. Savior, who?
Jesus Christ.
Can I hear you again?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus the Christ. The book of Hebrews, in most cases, is attributed to the authorship or penmanship of the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul. It really doesn't matter what personality is responsible for the New Testament, that is 21 New Testament epistles or 21 New Testament letters that make up our New Testament canonicals. The term canonicals means inspired writings. Amen. What is important is that all of the epistles written by the Holy Spirit, 2 Peter 1:20 says, knowing this verse, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. The prophecy of old came not by will of man, behold, man of God speak, as they were moved by the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So we should be clear in the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, that it is among the other 20 epistles of the New Testament, it being one of the 21, and if I mention this as one of them, there are 20 others beside it. This particular letter was penned by the Holy Spirit, and in most cases, because of the depth of New Testament typology, shadows, fashions, and figures, as well as Old Testament examples of things to come. The author's extraordinary knowledge in these areas, it is said among the apostles, the Apostle Paul appears to have been superior in such knowledge. Hence, he is given the credit for the authorship of this particular epistle. Touch them and say the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit
is the author.
Is the author
of the epistles.
Of the epistles.
In the fifth chapter of the book of Hebrews, verses 9 and 10, it would be appropriate to begin with verse number 8. Let's begin reading out loud together down through verse number 10. Though he were a son,
yet learned
obedience by the things which he suffered.
Being made perfect,
he became the author of eternal salvation
unto all them that obey him.
Called God
and high priest
after the order of Melchizedek. And all the people said,
amen.
Please underline the description, the author of eternal salvation. This particular description of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are interested in the term author here that comes from a Greek word that means he is or became the causative of eternal salvation, or eternal salvation is because of him, his obedience, his suffering, and his sacrifice being accepted by the eternal God. This then would speak to two things pertaining to Jesus Christ. If he is referred to as the article, the in front of, the description author, if he is the author of eternal salvation, often describing what he in fact is in terms of the causative. He is the action or the causative of eternal salvation. Then we need to understand two things. As an author, he is a writer. And we must understand that Jesus Christ was not only a writer through the Holy Spirit, he was also a speaker. So he spoke and he wrote. In his personification, when he came into the world in the days of his flesh, he was the Word personified of fits, and he spoke his word, and ultimately he gave the Holy Spirit to his apostles to write his word. After he gave them the Holy Spirit to likewise speak his word. We should understand that when it comes to his authorship, he is a writer, but he is also a speaker. He spoke his word, and through the Holy Spirit, he gave the apostles the command to write his word. Amen. As well as in the Old Testament, he spoke his word in creation, and then he gave Moses the commandment to write the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. He spoke his word to the prophets, and then there are some 40 authors. In the totality of the sum total of our 66 books, and he gave them the inspiration through the Holy Spirit to write his word. Now, you're looking at me strange, so first of all, let's go now to the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews, concerning to him being the author. Hopefully this is being recorded because I was asked to answer these questions. So in Hebrews chapter 12 now, the writer has listed a number of Old Testament witnesses who, in fact, walked with God by faith and died in faith, having not received the promise. God preparing some better thing for us that they without us should not be made perfect. That's in verse 40 if you read this in your spare time. And so now in Hebrews 12, in verses 1 and 2, after he has gone through his historical chronology of the Old Testament patriarchs and those that he has been inspired to leave as a testimony and record, who walked, who lived, and died in faith. Can the church say amen? Amen. And having received, the scripture says, and all these, verse 30, and having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise, means they received not, someone say, the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
Please make a note of that. The promise he is referring to here in the 39th verse of the 11th chapter of Hebrews is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that is what God has provided for his church. They, in fact, did not receive it because they were part of his types, shadows, fashions, figures, examples, and prophecy of things to come. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
And so this then is why they did not receive what we receive, inasmuch as it was not for their dispensation. Someone say, not for their dispensation.
Not for their dispensation.
But for our dispensation, appears the truth. Now then, chapter 12, verse number 1 and 2. Wherefore, seeing we
also
are compassed about
with so great a cloud of witnesses.
Now we has to do, Brother Ian, with the New Testament church. Those that have received, someone say, those that have received
the baptism
of the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
We, that is, those that are members of the New Testament church today, also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. The witnesses are those whom he has enumerated in the previous chapter lay aside every weight in one reading, and the sin which those of these do beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Verse 2.
Looking unto Jesus,
the author
and finisher of our faith.
Please underline the term. Someone say the author.
The author.
The article "the" means that he is the only one. He is exclusively the causative of our faith. And in this particular text, a different Greek word is used. He is the chief leader. He is the prince. He is the captain. He is the chief authority of our faith. So here is the question all of us tonight and those who will listen to this tape have to ask themselves: who is the authority in your life? Who is the authority in your life? If you are born again of water and spirit, baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, and filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the authority in your life is supposed to be Jesus Christ. Then he is supposed to be your chief leader. If he is your chief leader, then you will listen to his under shepherds. Because John said, he that is of God, heareth us.
Amen.
He that is not of God, heareth us not. Simple as that. This then is where the men, in so many words, are separated from the boys. The ladies are separated from the girls. Is when we determine who is the authority in our life. Who is the final authority? What do we go to and who do we go to make our final decisions and reach our final resolve?
Amen.
What is the stopgap? Where do we set the boundaries and what do we use to come to that determination as to where the boundaries lie that govern the dictates of our conversation or our manner of living? And so it is. This then is what we are told in verse number 2. Verse number 2, we begin.
Looking unto Jesus.
Say it again out loud now.
Jesus.
Looking unto
Jesus.
Jesus.
The author.
Of author.
And finisher.
Of our faith. And for the joy that was set before him. Through the cross.
Despising the shame. And is set down.
Set down
at the right hand of the throne of God.
And so the authority we're supposed to look to is who?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus. He is supposed to be, the term again means author, the chief leader, the prince, the captain, the chief authority of our faith. Now, in your spare time, let's go there now. Romans 10:17, the source of our faith. Where does our faith come from? Romans 10:17, read quickly. If you have it, turn quickly to Romans chapter 10 and verse number, let's start with verse number 14 through 17. Read. How then
shall they
call on him whom they have not believed?
How
shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Everyone read.
How
shall they hear without a preacher?
How shall they preach
except they be sent?
As it is written,
how beautiful are the feet of them
that preach the gospel
of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. They have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah said,
Lord,
who have believed our report? Verse 17.
So then,
faith is greeted, everyone.
So
then, cometh by hearing.
Hearing
by
the word of God.
So then, if he is the author, he is speaking. And if he is the author, he is writing. We'll get to the writing in just a moment. But as the author, he speaks first. And then he writes. And we wanted to show you, this is how God has always done it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And God said, he spoke first. Then he gave it to Moses to write. In the New Testament, he spoke first. Then he came into the world. And then before the New Testament was written, he spoke first. Then he commanded his apostles to write the New Testament. So he speaks, then he writes. And we have to understand, in this dispensation, it comes exclusively through the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is why Paul said, how then shall they call on him in whom they not believe? How shall they believe in him whom they not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? So we need to be clear. How is he the author and finisher of our faith? Because we heard him speak first. We believe because he gave us an hearing ear. And then, afterward, he began, after we believed and obeyed, to write where? Well, let's go see that. Let's go to the 20th, Proverbs 20, I think it is, or 23, one of them, look at there. Psalm, or Proverbs, excuse me, 20 or 23. Let's try 21st. Might be 23, my son, give me 23 and 26. Proverbs 23, 26. If you have Proverbs 23 and 26, I'm almost finished. I'm going to show you this so that you can understand how this is getting done. This is the way it's going to get done. If he's going to be the author of our eternal salvation, we're going to have to hear him, and then we're going to have to let him write it in our hearts. Otherwise, we don't have anything. Either we will hear, and then he will write it, or we won't get it. It's as simple as that. And the church say amen. Amen. How shall they hear without a preacher? They have to hear it. Can the church say hallelujah? Amen. All right, here's a prophecy. Verse 25, thy father and thy mother shall be glad. She that bare thee shall what?
Rejoice.
You think this is talking about the natural? This has nothing to do with the natural. There are many fathers and brothers that are not glad, because their children never have come to the wisdom of God. And who is the wisdom of God?
Jesus Christ.
Christ, the power of God, the wisdom of God, 1 Corinthians 1:24.
Amen.
So this has to do with those who have come to Christ. We come to Christ, our Father, which is Jesus Christ, our Mother, which is the church, shall be glad. She that bare us, which is the church, shall rejoice. Verse 26,
My son, give me
thine heart.
And let
thine eyes what?
Observe my ways.
This is God speaking to us as the, someone said, the sons of God.
The sons of God.
And so this is what he wants us to do. He wants us to give him our heart. And let our eyes what?
Observe his ways.
And you say, well, why does he want us to do that? Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews 10. Why does he want our heart? The songwriter said, all he wants is you. Nothing else will do. Not just a part, but he wants your heart. You ever heard that?
Mm-hmm.
All right, I think this is, yes, let's put this, let's read Hebrews chapter 10 and begin with verse 14 through 16. Well, let's say 14 through 17. If you have it, can you say amen?
Amen.
Let's read.
For by
one
offering
he hath perfected forever
them that are sanctified.
That would be those of us that have come into the New Church, Testament Church, saved, sanctified, and filled with what?
Holy Ghost.
Someone say the Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
All right, read on verse 15. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. But after that he had sinned before.
This is the covenant.
Say it again.
This is the covenant
that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts.
And in their minds.
And in their minds.
Will I write them.
And their sins and their iniquities.
Will I remember no more?
So why does he want us to give him our hearts? So he can put his laws in there and write them in our minds. Now, obviously, obviously, if he writes them in our minds and puts his laws in our heart, then he would be an author. The term author means the originator of eternal salvation, the causative. He is the originator, and he is the only origin of eternal salvation to all of them that what? That obey him. We just read from the 5th chapter, the 9th and 10th verse of the book of Hebrews. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So understand about authorship has to do with who is the authority in your life.
Amen.
To whom do you yield your members to?
Mm-hmm.
Whom servants you are?
To
whom you yield your members to obey.
Mm-hmm.
Paul said, whom servants you are?
Amen.
Whom you obey. Who is the authority?
Says.
What's the final authority in your life? Where does it stop? Where does it begin? And where does it end? Who is your Alpha? And who is your Omega? Who is your first? And who is your last? He is supposed to be the author of what?
Your faith.
Eternal salvation. Is he not?
Amen.
Go to the 8th chapter of the book of Hebrews, verse number 10. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So I want you to see the reverse now. So does somebody say, well, I just read, he's going to put his laws in my heart and write them in my mind. Well, let's read it now, the 8th chapter, 10th verse of Hebrews. Let's read. For this
is the covenant.
Is the covenant. I will make with the house of Israel after those days,
saith
the Lord.
I
will put my laws into their mind
and write them in their
hearts.
And I will be
to them a God.
And they shall
to me a people. Praise the Lord. So however you want to say. Say he puts them in your heart or writes them in your heart or puts them in your spirit or writes them in your spirit. My son, give me that heart and let that eyes observe my ways. I feel my whole sanctified heart that is jumping much in my chest. I feel many sanctified up here.
Yes, sir.
Well, many of us don't know anything about, someone say authorization. You need to allow God to have the appropriate authorization in your life by operating under his authority. Decently and
order.
Because God is not the author
of confusion.
So people who are, someone say LA preachers are confused. They are outside of the boundaries of the authorization of God. All right, now then, how does then faith come in by what?
Hearing.
Hearing by the what?
Word of God.
So God then gives us faith through our hearing. He writes in our heart through our hearing. He puts it in our spirit and in our mind through our
hearing.
Now, turn to someone and say, how does that work?
How does that work?
Go to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. We'll keep this simple as possible. Turn to your neighbor and say, how does that work?
How does that work?
Well, let the scripture tell us how that works. Galatians chapter 5. And we will go now. Verse number 5 and 6. Let's read that out loud together. For we through the Spirit
wait
for the hope of righteousness
by faith.
For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything nor uncircumcision,
but faith
which worketh by love. How does faith work?
By love.
It comes by hearing. It works by love. And Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my words. If a man love me, he will keep my commandments. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If a loved man love me, he will keep my words. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Which means faith worketh by obedience. He became the author of eternal salvation. The Bible says, through obedience and suffering. So it is. Turn to someone and say, how does that work? Turn to someone and say, it works by love. Say, you love God, you do what God says. If God is the author, the authority in your life, then you and I will be obedient to the word of who?
God.
Word of God. Finally, brethren, in the second chapter of the book of James, in verses 19 through 24, say amen.
Amen.
So we now bow together.
Thou believest.
James said, thou believest that there is one God.
Thou doest well. The devils also
believe. The devils believe also.
And tremble.
Tremble. The devil is smarter than some of you Trinitarians out there. Can we say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
The devil knows there's only one God. Praise the Lord. Tremble they do, and tremble they ought to. Give the church say amen. What's his name?
Jesus Christ.
Verse 20. But wilt thou know,
O vain man,
that faith
without works is dead.
Now here is your Old Testament example. Verse number 20 to 21.
Was not
Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac
his son upon
the altar? Please write in my margin, example. This is an Old Testament example. Abraham is our example. He is the father of our faith. Hence James is using him in this particular text. These things happen to them for our example, for our admonition upon whom the ends of the world come, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 1 through 4. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? What is the answer? Of course he was. Verse number 22.
Seest thou how faith wrought with his works. And by works was faith made perfect.
The answer is, do you see how faith works? That's the question James is answering. Do you not see how faith works? Verse 23.
And the scripture was fulfilled.
Abraham believed God.
It was imputed unto him
for righteousness, and he was called
the friend of God.
Now he says, if you can't see the example, do you not see where the scripture confirms? First of all, there was belief. Then Abraham obeyed because he believed. Then he was justified because he obeyed, because he believed. Then the scripture confirmed, thirdly, that he was justified because he believed and obeyed what he believed. And then finally, it was imputed to him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Verse number 24. Ye see then how that by works a man is justified
not
by faith only.
And not by faith only. So, brothers and sisters, tonight in my close, if God is the authority in your life, then you will not only believe, you will obey, and you will not only come to hear the word of God, but you will put yourself in a position for him to write it in your heart. You are here tonight because you believe God, you obey God, and you came for him not only to speak to you, but also to write it in your heart. And for that you'll be blessed. I'm not going to give one of the most extraordinary testimonies that I have experienced since I've been pastoring. I had a very lively conversation today with one of the professionals in our church. And we were talking about the most recent meetings held up with the ambassador, Andrew Young, to assist those in the southeastern part of Michigan, Wayne County and Macomb, enrolling in these healthcare programs where they had many of them and never had any healthcare of any kind for the entirety of their lives. And how we sat with the ambassador as they filmed for the entirety of yesterday. These people were now enrolling, some 46,000 of them who are eligible now for healthcare. And I wouldn't call it healthcare, I would call it medical care. Because if you don't have salvation, you don't have any healthcare. You only have medical care. Because after you receive medical care and you don't receive salvation, you are in the worst health you possibly could be in. Because gaining health care is the equivalent or part of the declaration of Jesus Christ, what doth it profit man if he should gain the whole world? Lose and lose his own soul. What shall man give in
exchange
for his soul? But I will say that through this effort, if we are able to expand the chaplains program, which Pastor Eunice Jones and others were working with our chaplains program to baptize over 400 people in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and for them to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now we have some health care going on, where not only is it managed care, end of life, it's managed faith, end of life. And when we can bring the gospel to these people in these institutions, which now means that we are supposed to be able to now move from the numbers of 19 facilities that we are now to possibly taking the gospel to almost 50,000 people in southeastern Michigan, then we'll be able to say that we're doing what is called greater works. Let's all rise for the, someone say greater works.
Greater works.
Greater works.